You're listening to HowStreet.com Radio, available online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com. Welcome to HowStreet.com Radio, the online source for market opinions. Here is Jim Goddard.
My guest is Danielle Park, editor of the popular blog Juggling Dynamite and president of Venable Park Investment Council Incorporated. Welcome to the show, Danielle.
Hey, Jim. Long time no talk.
Well, apparently you've been having holidays and so on, which is a good thing. We all know that. We need to recharge ourselves.
We try and fit things in, don't we?
The oil sector continues to slide in Canada. Was this a case of holding on to old-time technology for too long?
Yeah, well, it's a case of the remarkable boom that came out of the credit bubble, right? All the hyper-investment that went into the sector, starting with the resurgence in off the bottom of 2000, 2001, when the sector was widely underinvested and hated, and then you got the infusion of all the funds that came into the sector through the credit bubble and peaking in 2008, and then you had a bunch more in the QE aftermath, tons of cheap capital looking for homes, and you really were getting the benefit of all that now because we have epic amount of supply coming online month after month from all over the world, not just in North America. And at the same time, we have this, you know, slow, plodding global economy, which has been contracting essentially in terms of its demand for the past few years. So all that really has taken the bid out of crude, and it has, you know, it's the efficiencies in the equipments we use, it's the alternatives that are available to supplement energy and the grid. All that together is really a perfect storm for forcing energy prices or oil prices, crude prices back down. You know, another comment that people have asked me recently, people have been saying, well, you know, and you've talked about it before too, why don't we see as much relief at the pump, you know, that we've seen this remarkable plunge in oil from 140-ish, you know, range at the peak in 08 to less, you know, about $40 today, and why hasn't gas come down more? And the answer is really quite counterintuitive. It's that there's so many people pumping crude today trying to get cash flow because they're over indebted, and because as the price has crashed, they're really in need of revenue income. As that happens, the refiners of the world get inundated with product, and they can only process it so quickly to make it into gasoline. And so they, being no dozers, say, hey, you guys all want us, and there's a deluge of customers, so what do? They increase their spread. So they put, it's easier for the refiners to increase the price they're charging in this environment, and that means that the consumer doesn't see the decline in gas the way they might otherwise expect.
You know, in the long term, though, this is going to bite them in the butt, because you mentioned in your blog, in England, they're building lanes that will automatically charge your electric car. So with these high gasoline prices continuing, I still want to get an electric car, which overall was bad for the oil business, no matter which way you look at it.
Yeah, well, the electric car is a technology that should have been here for decades already. You know, if you think about the EV1, the GM, you know, who killed the electric car, all that stuff. We've had the technology. We've known it was brilliant for years, but sadly, the status quo was so heavily invested in the oil industry that you just had suppression at every turn. But now, even as the price of oil has come down, I think that, you know, the revelation, the dawning of the electric car and of the incredible savings on every front, that are available to the planet, to families, in that technology. And also at a time when the world is looking for where best to invest to actually revive demand and jobs, right? So when you look around, we've had all these monetary magicians wasting capital, throwing good money after bad, and all these shenanigans in financial markets, borrowing in cheap credit to buy back your own shares, all this nonsense, which has nothing to do with real demand or, you know, real strengths or sustainable development, things that will help humanity go forward. That's all just short-term strategies to get a few people's, you know, bonus bucks up. But if you look at things that make sense for the longer run, certainly alternative energies and smarter energies and cheaper energies are a no-brainer. And so I'm happy to say that even with the coming down the price, you're seeing behavioral shift, and it's at every level. People are starting to say, wow, that makes so much sense. And, you know, we humans are herd following instruments, right? Like, if you think about it, that clip of the UK electric recharging lane that's along the highway, you know, they're having those lanes put on highways all over the world. There's some in Ontario even, where if you're driving an electric car or if you're driving a car that has multiple passengers, you're allowed to go in this outside, you know, quote, free lane. And so I think that the more people that are seen driving in those lanes, you know, not only are they going to be, you have basically electricity available at every, you know, hydro pole. So it's this whole idea about range anxiety, which, you know, all the naysayers have focused on, oh, electric cars won't work because what if you run out of battery? What if you, well, there's recharging capability, not only in, you know, recharging stations, which are now being spread out all over the continent, but they actually have the technology to just have the road itself recharge you as you drive. So there's just no need for this whole fear about range anxiety. I mean, electricity is more available than gas stations, and yet people drive, you know, realizing on gas that they need to refill and they can't go too far without seeing a gas station. So we really have a mental shift now. People are starting to wake up to the realization that this is in their best interest. This is not just in the planet's best interest, this is in the actual best interest of humans and their families, and especially in saving more and spending less.
I mean, I calculated my wife's daily commute, which uses $35, $45 worth of gas a week. I said if you were using electricity, it would be $2.75.
Mm-hmm. If you were paying for the electricity, right? But
yes.
If you're getting it at solar charging plants, for example, or through your own power wall, if you're able to collect your own solar power, you can literally drive for free. So it's what you call a no-brainer, Jim.
We'll have more with Danielle Park right after this.
More and more people are looking to the internet for intelligent, riveting, and thought-provoking interviews. To advertise on the Goddard Report and TalkDigitalNetwork.com, call 604-699-8600. 604-699-8600.
Welcome back. We're speaking with Danielle Park. Commodities across the globe are taking a pounding. Any hope for them?
Any hope for them? Of course there's hope, Jim. There's hope for everything that's of value. The problem is at what price, right? So we've had this era where speculation and financialization and credit have pumped the price of assets far beyond what's reasonable in any kind of a supply and demand dynamic. And so that's what you're seeing now. You know, the capital flows moving out of emerging markets, moving out of financial assets and commodities, and moving back to cash, moving back to investment in the real economy, moving back to things like the U.S. dollar as a safe haven. And all that means that the great commodity boom has officially ended. We've been saying that for quite some time. But if you look at, for example, the Canadian resource sector, the venture exchange, Jim, the index itself is below where it began at inception in 2000. So there's every evidence to believe that the commodities boom that began, as I said, in 2000, 2001, you know, that whole coinciding with China coming into the World Trade Organization and the world having not invested in commodities and production for about two decades prior to that, set up a perfect boom scenario where things really took off. But that all peaked in about 2008. And then since then, you've had this financial speculation return, but the demand's not there, the supply's off the charts, and you keep seeing mean reversion in many of these assets like copper, for example. You know, copper has already come down significantly from where it rebounded into 2011, but you could see another 50 to 70% decline in copper from here. You know, oil, we've been talking about $40 being the retest that was imminent, we thought, in this cycle, and we're in fact back at 40. But if we're correct about the end of the secular boom period here, you could see oil now break below 40 and trade in a range of perhaps, you know, 20 to 40 even for an extended period of time. So at the end of secular booms, you don't get a V-shaped bounce. You get a long, slow, drug-out, you know, sideways market. And I think that's indeed what we may see. You know, things like iron ore is another example. Iron ore is an excellent barometer for world growth in demand, and it's down 60% now since January of 2014, and may indeed fall significantly further from here. The emerging market index, you know, I was saying capital flowing back out of emerging market economies and currencies. That's a big story right now, the crashing currency markets. You know, we saw China devalue this week, last week, Jim. It's all part and parcel for this desperation for a shrinking pot of exports. You know, in a world where credit is now coming out, after many years of expanding, now credit is coming out of the system, and that air, if you think of it as air coming out of a tire, everything comes down to a lower level. Well, the economies and companies and people that have added on tons of debt in the expansion phase are now particularly ill-prepared and desperate for cash flow because of their debt payments. The debt payments maintain the same while the revenues and income levels fall. So you're seeing everybody slashing whatever they can in terms of their currency to get their prices down so that you can have, grabbing greater exports from whatever's on sale in the world. But what's really amazing is we saw very similar, this is not a new pattern by any stretch, Jim. We saw a similar pattern, for example, in 1994. China did a dramatic devaluation in 1994 as well, and that led on to, a following of suit in emerging markets and other currencies all over the world, which ultimately led to the 1998 Asian crisis, which brought down long-term capital, which was when, you know, you first saw the Federal Reserve stepping in with the bankers to really try and paper over their own mistakes and reckless behaviors that led to that whole big implosion. And I think now we're just getting some sort of truth back, some revelation about, you know, that there's only demand, there's only the value has to be dictated by market forces and not by financial shenanigans. And so you've got the emerging market index of companies that is now below the QE3 channel it's been trading in since 2012. In fact, it's back, Jim, at the level it broke out of in October of 2010, and that's a pattern we're seeing all over the place. A lot of things are breaking down again. The TSX itself is, falling to the level it was at 2007. We're at the same level we were in 2007 today. 8 years ago, the FTSE's back to where it was in February of 13. The Dow today down again heavily, back to where it was in 14. So all this mean reversion that has happened already at the front end in things like commodities and resource companies are sort of showing the world where these other broader markets ought to go as well, because the whole dream of QE was that they could patch up the system with just more debt and more recycling of credit. And the reality is that that has not been the elixir that you hoped for the global economy, and the demand has steadily declined. And you see that pretty much everywhere you look. So I think that the next leg of this is for a revelation from things like financial shares in Canada, the REITs. They've both started to mean revert, decline, but they have an incredibly far way to go here just to get back to where they were in 2012 when the QE3 nonsense began. You know, the Canadian Financial Index would have to lose 35%. That's just to get back to where it was in 12. And I think that's entirely realistic to think when everything else is already back where it was, you know, in 12 or even 2009 and below. You know, you don't live in a world where everything's decoupling from that. It's in fact highly coupled.
Is it going to help Canada that our dollar appears to be in free fall?
Well, our dollar is getting the comeuppance it deserves, because after the last, the last recession, we had an opportunity there to try and diversify away from fossil fuels as our bread and butter. But unfortunately, people, because there was a quick V-shaped recovery in 2009 on all the stimulus that was unleashed around the world, people didn't want to believe that we were in a new paradigm and needed a new plan, right? They thought, oh good, we can just go back to what we were doing. And that was, in fact, what Canada did. Well, unfortunately, it was a bad decision, because 7 years later, we're now back with that commodity that people are not paying paying for as much, don't want as much, is, you know, a dime a dozen everywhere at the moment. And that's our main, you know, sort of, offering to the world. So our dollar was incredibly overvalued because we missed our opportunity to reinvent ourselves in an intelligent way. And now we're really behind the eight ball. But as I say, we're in good company because many of the economies in the world, certainly the emerging markets, certainly Australia, New Zealand, many of these economies did the exact same thing. The bottom in 2008 should have been more behavior changing. The financial crisis in 2008 and the losses that hit financial markets into 2009 should have been behavioral changing. Unfortunately, the policymakers didn't want to change course either, so they stepped in and just repumped everything full of credit in the hopes that would somehow buy some more time. Well, it certainly did buy a bit more time, but if you look at any of these, like I was mentioning, every so often I'll pick up a classic like Manias, Panics, and Crashes by Charles Kindleberger, and I was reading it again last night at the gym, and it's, you know, it's just classic stuff. He looks at all these financial cycles, you know, since the 1600s in this case, and the components are always the same. And currencies, are very often the canary in the coal mine. Once they start, you know, having major, changes in trend, you typically, they're much better. Them and the bond market are typically much better than the stock market at, signaling, you know, a secular change. And so I think that's what we're seeing. We're in the midst of a secular change, and stocks and high yield debt is often trading with the equity cycle, and high yield debt's been rolling over significantly in the last year. The junk bond index in the United States is down over 10%. You know, the FTSE 100 is down over 10% in the United States, in the United Kingdom. So I think that we're just catching up in North America in some ways, to what's already been rolling out around the world. And, you know, it's a good thing because, it has to happen. If we don't let prices get back to where they should be in fair value, there'll be no opportunities for anyone. Like, it'll all be stagnant and stuck and nothing productive will come. So we need to really clean house and let this happen. So I'm quite encouraged. And yes, eventually Canada will be helped by a lower currency because we have a less competitive economy and we need to reinvent ourselves and come up with some new, smarter ideas.
Well, when you said diversify, 3D printing is going to need lots and lots of little different colored plastic beads to make things. Why not make those beads in Alberta where they have the oil to make it?
Yeah, that could be. That could be for sure. You have to really, that's the kind of thing you have to think about. You have to find new secondary products and services that are not just rocks and trees in their very basic form, right? That's where the most evolved economies figure out ways to refine and make new products that the world needs instead of just be the hardware store.
Danielle, always fascinating to chat with you. And if people want to find out more, check out her blog, Juggling Dynamite. My guest has been Danielle Park. You're listening to HowStreet.com Radio. Find us on Twitter at Talk Digital Net. Check out our popular YouTube channel, Talk Digital Network. Questions or comments about the show can be sent to info@HowStreet.com. I'm Jim Goddard.
Comments made on HowStreet.com Radio are an expression of opinion only and should not be construed in any matter whatsoever as recommendations to buy or sell any financial instrument at any time. Available online at TalkDigitalNetwork.com. HowStreet.com Radio is a production of HowStreet Media Incorporated.